Please stand. Please kneel. Please stand. Let us pray. Remember your mercies, O Lord, and with your eternal protection, sanctify your servants, for whom Christ your Son, by the shedding of his blood, established the paschal mystery, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen. A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see, and those who have not heard shall ponder it. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance that would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hide their faces. Spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We all had gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought more of his destiny? When he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people, a grave was assigned to him among the wicked and a burial place with evildoers, though he had done no wrong nor spoken any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him with infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death, and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord. A reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obeyed him. The word of the Lord.
Praise and honor to you, O Lord Jesus. and on her. To you, O Lord Jesus Christ.
The gospel reading may be found at number 1146 in your hymnals. Please follow along and join in reading the parts of the crowd. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to where there was a garden, in which he and his disciples entered. Judas, the betrayer, his betrayer, also knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered him,
"Jesus."
He said to them,
"I am."
Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They said,
"Jesus."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter,
"Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guard seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was with the gatekeeper, was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of the disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they had made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. A high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, He denied it and said,
"I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, Again, Peter denied it, and immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning, and they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order to not be defiled so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him, At this Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him, In order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the King of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king?"
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the King of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one, but Barabbas."
Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head and clothed him in a purple cloak. And as they came to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews,"
and they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And Pilate said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, Pilate said to him,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, we have to die, because he is the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and he went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was a preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
Take him away, crucify him.
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have only Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven into one piece from top down. So they said to one another, "In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots.' This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
Please kneel. Please stand.
Now, since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken and that they be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and then of the other who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by.
The Gospel of the Lord. So when we began our Lenten journey this year, we began it on February 14th, the date that we commemorate most frequently, Valentine's Day. Here at Nativity of Mary, I preached on the focus of the imagery of the prophet Joel, the first reading for the liturgy, who exhorted the Jewish people to rend their hearts, not their garments. Now, looking at the providence of God for our Lenten journey this year, I want to end Lent with where we began it, by reflecting on the human heart. At the start of Lent, we focused on our own hearts and how we are meant to look into them and to see the areas that may need to change and allow the Lord to touch those broken areas of our lives with his grace. Essentially, what Lent was meant for this year was purification. But as we gather today on Good Friday, it is now the Lord who bears his heart to us. And he asks if we will be near him to share in his broken heart. As the scriptures and the stations of the cross state, was there any sorrow like his sorrow? And no doubt a large part of our Lord's sorrow was the fact that his closest friends and those that he came to save refused to share in his passion. On Calvary, our Lord endured all the horrors that humanity could dish out, and his heart broke. He didn't move towards the false consolations that we often cling to in our own times of pain in our own lives. Things like plotting revenge, harboring anger or resentment or bitterness. That false consolation that never heals, but we often find ourselves going to in the midst of strife. Instead, our Lord, as his heart breaks, shows love. Even to the end, when he begs his Father for mercy on those who truly do not deserve it. The love that existed within the heart of Jesus did not even stop giving as he perished on the cross and gave up his spirit, but it continued to pour forth even after his passing. For we are told in the gospel how a soldier to appease Pilate came forward and stabbed the side of our Lord. If enough cruelty had not yet been shown to our Lord, then this was the ultimate act of hatred, desecrating his dead body. But even in that moment of such utter darkness and evil, the heart of God just kept giving. And all of the historians of the church have long interpreted this moment of the piercing of Christ's side as the birth of the church. Just as Eve came from Adam's side, so from Christ's side was the gift of the church, the sacraments, pure life. For this is how love is meant to act. It is meant to be given, to be shared, not based on a condition, but most especially when it would seem most unreasonable to love. See, if there was one place where I could imagine love would not be present, it would be Calvary. A place where all the hatred and sin of the entire world conspired against the most beautiful and kind and gentle person that this world has ever known. And yet it is on Calvary, in contrast to all of these evils, that love is most clearly seen. What a strange juxtaposition in this world. Let this reality sink deeply inside of our hearts today. Love is not meant to shine only in situations that are easy to enter into and be around. Love becomes most pointed in the midst of the difficult, the dark, even the hopeless, as it is the force that reveals the very presence of God. For do we not believe that God is love? And when love shows up, so too does God. See, love is no fickle force that fades away. It is the substance of pure creativity and new life. And when we approach Calvary, our Lord indeed desires to share this love with us, as it is the moment of his greatest creation in this world. The moment when a selfless sacrifice opened the doors to eternal life that were closed because of a selfish action so long ago. How powerful is this revelation that God has given to this world, to show us how from a broken heart, new life can come forth. For when a heart breaks, there is vulnerability, demanding the possibility for docility, as the heart at that moment of break can no longer defend itself. The cage is broken. To this point at the papal audience this week in Rome on Wednesday, Pope Francis addressed those gathered and brought before them a profound witness of two men who were from the Holy Land. One was Palestinian, the other was Israeli. And he said, "Both of these men that you see before you have lost their daughters in this war, but both are friends with one another. They don't look at the enmity of war, but they look at the friendship of two men who love each other and who went through the same crucifixion. Let us think of this very beautiful testimony of these two people who suffered with the loss of their daughters from the war in the Holy Land, who have allowed this tragedy to become a testimony for peace. At the midst of the crucifixion, love is seen. See, witnesses like this are the fruit that is possible when we encounter Christ on Calvary, as the encounter allows us to witness a love that heroically gave in the midst of absolute hardship and tragedy. See, as so often happens in the life of Christ, he models to humanity what is possible if we respond with God to the trials of this world. To be willing to give one's heart to God, knowing full well that the world will beat it, bruise it, reject it, even pierce it when we think there is nothing left to take from us. But after all of these things, love can be brought forth in a miraculous way with God. The fact that Christ draws us to Calvary today is to remind us that he not only wants to share his own heart with us, but also that he would be willing to invite us to share our heart with him, that he would give us the strength to endure our own Calvaries in this world. As he sought for one to console him, now he is the one ready to console us. As we draw near to the cross for veneration today, it is a beautiful opportunity to share hearts and to allow the pains, hardships, sorrows, and difficulties of our own lives to be touched by the grace of Christ and his sacrifice. As you watch your brothers and sisters come forward in the very long veneration that will take place at the cross, let us pray for one another that we would be given strength from this cross today to bring forth the fruits of love that Christ won on Calvary. Please stand. This time I invite you to put down your kneelers. The ancient tradition of the church is to have 10 petitions that are said all over the world on Good Friday. And after the deacon proclaims the prayer to be said, we'll kneel, pray in silence, and rise again.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church spread throughout all the world may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church, to govern the holy people of God.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, by whose decree all things are founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you, their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for our Archbishop Bernard Hebda, for all bishops, priests, and deacons of the Church, and for the whole of the faithful people.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace, all may serve you faithfully through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for catechumens, that our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that having received forgiveness for all their sins through the waters of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, who make your Church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of all catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for all our brothers and sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one Church.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Mighty ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together by integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for the Jewish people, to whom the Lord our God spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, who bestow your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your Church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God himself.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, who created all things, to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you, come to rest. Grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you, and so in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of the human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to his will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart, and the rights of people, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may through your gift be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, to God the Father Almighty, that he may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, health to the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Let us kneel. Let us stand. Almighty and ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may the prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice because in their hour of need, your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord. I invite you to please face the back of the church at the baptismal font as the cross is brought forward.
Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Behold the wood of the cross, on which hung the salvation of the world. Come, let us adore. Thank you.
Please be seated. Please stand. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Please kneel. Those who are to help with the distribution of communion could come forward at this time. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that partaking of this mystery we may have life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a couple of very brief announcements. A reminder that after this liturgy is completed, there is no formal dismissal. If you could please depart in silence to keep the reverent and solemn kind of festivities of this day, it would be greatly appreciated. The church will remain open until 5 o'clock for private prayer. There will also be Stations of the Cross tonight at 7 p.m. The church will be opened at 6:30 p.m. if you wish to pray early. If you also wish to donate, every Good Friday, the donations go to the Holy Land and the needs of the holy sites. There is a collection basket in the back if you would like to make a donation that will go directly to the Holy Land. Finally, the novena for Divine Mercy begins today, and there are pamphlets at both entrances if you would like to grab one as you leave. Bow down for the blessing.
Bow down for the blessing.
May abundant blessings, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people, who have honored the death of your Son and the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.